السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear respected brothers, we start first and foremost by praising Allah Azza wa Jal, the King. So we start first and foremost by praising Allah Azza wa Jal, the King, the Master, the Sustainer, the Creator of the seven heavens and the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my brothers, is the one who created life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created death. Allah azza wa jal is the creator of all things. That which you see and that which you don't. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who sustains the seven heavens and the earth. So we praise Him. And we send peace and blessings upon His beloved creation, the best creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, and that is our Habib, and the Habib of Allah, that is our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tonight is titled, Is Life Just a Game? Is life just a game? Why are we here, my brothers? Why did Allah create me? Why do you wake up in the morning? Who knows what the dua is for when you wake up? Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'da ma amatana wa ilayhin. We praise the King of Kings, the one who gave me life after he gave me death. So I'm not going to tell you what happened last week. I'll tell you what happened this morning. Every single one of you was dead. Who gave you life? Why? Why did Allah give you life after He gave you death? And why are we saying, Wa ilayhi nushur, and Ya Allah, to you we shall all return? I ask you, my brother, did Allah give you life this morning because He needs you to go to work? Did Allah give you life this morning? And I'm not saying this is haram. I don't want anyone saying, I think the brother is saying work is haram. No. Open your mind. Let's have depth of understanding. Did Allah give me life today so I can take the children to school? Or did Allah give me life maybe so I can go shopping and get the groceries for my wife? Did Allah give me life so I can collect more money and buy a house or buy a bigger house or maybe to buy a car? Why did Allah give me life after He gave me death? You know, my brothers, how many times do we honestly ask ourselves, why am I alive? What's the purpose? What's the core? Ya Allah, what do you want from me? Why are you giving me life, then giving me death, giving me life, then giving me death? Then there will come a time it will only be death. There will come a time, my brother, they say, al-nawmu موت الأصغر والموت نوم الأكبر. Sleep is the minor death and death is the major sleep. Ya Allah, why are you playing with my life like a yo-yo, up and down, life, death, what do you want? Allah says in one clear statement, we did not create the human, nor did we create the jinn. إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah created you for worship, my brother. Allah created you, and liyabudun does not mean just salah and namaz, and to know Allah, to glorify Allah, to understand Allah, to praise Him, to worship Him, to call others to Him. This is my job. This is why Allah gave you life this morning after He gave you death. My brother, sometimes the concept is a bit extreme, you know. My brothers, Allah does not care. Understand, Allah does not care how big your house is. Allah does not care how much money you have. Allah does not care what your status or your position is in society. You could be the king, or you could be the one who cleans the toilets. Allah does not care. Whatever you have, He gave it to you anyway. What are you so proud of? Sometimes people walk around in the streets with some sort of arrogance, pride, that I'm something, you know. Brother, who are you? Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he says, how can the one who passed through the passage of urine twice, not once, twice you passed through the passage of urine from your father, then into your mother, and then you came out of your mother. So twice you went through the passage of urine, not gold. Urine. How can this man have pride? What are you so proud of? Your money? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, oh my slave, did there not come a time when you were nothing? He says, لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا You were not even in the memory of man. You were nothing. You were not even a drop of sperm. You were nothing. Allah is reminding you. Oh son of man, was there not a time in history when you did not exist? Where did you come from? And who gave you life? Please, brothers, if you can move forward, please. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying what? لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا You are nothing. We created you. Allah is saying, we created you from what? My brother, what was your beginning? Malish, please forgive me. Maybe it's a bit harsh. But sometimes the odd slap in the face wakes you up, you know? From what did Allah create me? From a drop of sperm, a nutfa. Your beginning was a drop of sperm. Malish, forgive me. I know the sisters in the back, but I don't want to lose this opportunity. My brother, if there was sperm on this table, would you pick it up? I challenge anyone in this room. Would you pick it up? What if I paid you just to pick it up? That was your beginning. Allah says, we created you from that. From najasa, from a nutfa, you are nothing. We created you. We fashioned you. We designed you in three layers of darkness. In the darkness of your mother's stomach, in the darkness of her womb, in the darkness of the night. We fashioned you, we designed you, until you became the best of creation. You went from a nutfa to what? To the best of creation. By whose help? What help did you have? What assistance did you have in the process of your own creation? He says, for 9 months in the womb of your mother, we sustained you. We gave you life. We gave you eyes. We gave you a nose. We gave you a mouth. We gave you ears. We gave you hands. You are nothing. Then from a small womb, speak to any woman that's given birth. Ask her, how does logically, how does a baby like this come from a hole like this? Who made the impossible possible? Allah. And then He put milk in your mother's breast. You were helpless. You couldn't walk. You had a mouth, but you couldn't eat. You had hands, but you couldn't hold. You had legs, but you couldn't walk. Allah says, we were there for you. We put milk in your mother's breast. In summer, it's cold. In winter, it's warm. At the last process of exit, at the last moment of exit, the breast milk, it's not milk, it's a colorless liquid. At the last moment, Allah turns it into milk. Where were you in this process? And then throughout the years, you were dependent on Allah until you became a young, healthy man. And instead of thanking Allah, what did we do? We said, now I'm dependent. I'm a man. I'm something. My brother, really, what are you? What are you? What something do you think you are? You are here because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to exist. And instead of worshipping Him and turning to the one who was there for me when no one was there for me, what did I do? I turned my back on Allah and said, Ya Allah, I'm busy. I'm busy. I have studies. I have work. I want to enjoy my life. Could there be a greater zulm than this? I ask you, forget halal haram. I'm not here to tell you halal haram. Brother, you can do whatever you want. Your business, inshallah. But I ask you, can there be a greater zulm than this? There was a pious man, very pious, very famous man. And he was sitting in the majlis, sitting in the gathering, and everyone that's walking by is giving him respect, showing him some respect and honor. Until one man, he walked past him and did not acknowledge his existence. He walked past, didn't show him anything. So this pious man, although he's pious, he's still a makhluk, he's still insane. Something didn't sit right in his heart. Everyone is kissing my hand and showing me, and you walk past. So he goes to the man. He says, brother, don't you know who I am? He says, brother, I know you better than you know yourself. You know me better than I know myself? He says, your beginning was a nutfa. And your ending is a dead corpse. And in between, you're a vessel of urine and feces. If I sit long enough, some of you will have to go to the toilet, yes? Yes? You're a vessel of what? Urine and feces. He says, your beginning is a nutfa, your end is a dead corpse, and in between you're a vessel. You're a container of urine and feces. Who are you? The Sheikh says, you do know me better than I know myself. My brother's pride belongs to Allah. It does not belong to you and I. Please, brothers, if we can silence our phones, please. Pride belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It does not belong to you and I. I think it's one of these phones here. Which phone is it? Please, if we can have all phones on silent, please. So my brothers, really, who are we, man? Sometimes Allah, He gives you a business. Alhamdulillah, you're making some money. Instead of thanking Him, what do we do? Brother, I work hard. This is because of my action. This is because of my amal. This is because of my family. Wallahi, my brothers, if this is your heart, and you think you're going to be safe on the Day of Judgment, you have no idea. So what is the purpose of life? Allah says, we created you to worship me, to know me, to glorify me, to understand me. Please, brothers, please, I beg you, turn these phones either off, silent, vibrations. This really does distract me. Whose phones are these? Please, I'm sorry, but wallahi, I lose all distraction. Thank you, Zafar. Allah says that you were created for ibadah, for worship. This is what Allah wants from you. Nothing more and nothing less. And this life, my brothers, is a challenge. This life is a continuous battle between good and evil. And this challenge will continue, my brother, to the day you die. Abdullah ibn al-Imam Ahmad, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Abdullah, his son, he says, I was there when my father was dying. Abdullah is narrating the story. He says, I was there when my father was dying. He says that my father was going through this state of sakarat al-mawt, conscious, then unconscious, then conscious, then unconscious. He says that when my dad was conscious, he says, La ba'd, la ba'd. No, not yet. No, not yet. Then my father lost consciousness. So Abdullah says, I became worried. What does my father mean by no, not yet? No, not yet. He says, I feared that maybe he did that. He says, I feared. Maybe my father does not want to leave this dunya. He said, maybe that's why he's saying, no, not yet. He says, so I waited anxiously next to my father, hoping and praying that he would wake up. Then when he woke up, I asked him, my father, why were you saying, la ba'd, la ba'd? Why are you saying, no, not yet, no, not yet? He said, my son Shaitan is standing in front of me and he's biting on his fingernails and he's saying, Ahmed, you slipped out of my hands. Ahmed, you slipped out of my hands. So I said to him, no, not yet. Not until I'm dead is the battle between you and I finished. He says, no, not yet. This battle between us and Shaitan, my brothers, is till the death. And the ulama say that at the moment of your death, Shaitan will focus his full attention on you. And many of us, we think, brother, I'm going to be okay, relax, man. Alhamdulillah, I'm Muslim. Brother, alhamdulillah, I'm Muslim. I will pass, inshallah. How come we have this confidence? And Imam Ahmad said, no, not yet. He did not have the confidence that you and I have. Shaykh Al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, and he speaks about this particular incident. And he says, my brother, that at the moment of your death, Shaytan will dedicate 100% of his attention on you. And he will not leave you until you commit kufr before you die. So many of us now, we think, brother, it's okay, I will pass, inshallah. My brother, now we are young and strong and healthy and capable. And Shaytan gives me 3% of his attention and I fail the test. A woman walks by and what happens? What happens? Some music comes on, we start doing these ones. Fajr namaz is being called and you hear the call. Where are we? Shaitan is giving you 5% and we fail every day. But we are foolish enough to think that when he gives me 100%, I'm going to pass. My brothers, we need to wake up. We need to wake up. My brothers, I tell you sincerely that if we die in the state that we are in, we have big problems, man. Big problem. My brothers, Allah gave us life for deen, man. This is why we're here. Your job on dunya is to establish Islam. That's your job. Many people today are asking, brother, what is your profession? I'm an engineer, brother. Brother, I'm a doctor. Brother, I'm a director of this company. And we say it with pride. My brother, I'm sorry to say, but you have not understood. Your profession is you're a Muslim. You are a da'i. You are a caller to Islam. That is your job. That is our job, my brothers. Today, my brothers, we are failing. Look at the problems of the youth. Problems of the youth. What are our problems? You know, I come from Australia. For many of you, a world that you only see in movies. We don't have halal, haram in Australia. Everything is halal. You know, here when you want to do some haram, young boys, yeah, when we want haram, we can't do it at home. Where do we go? There are places we go. If you want to talk to your girlfriend, do you talk to her in front of your father on the phone? Where do you go? You hide. You hide in darkness like a rat hides in darkness. You know what a rat is? Do you have rats in this country? Like a rat. Thinking that Allah can't see me, you know? I ran away from my father, the fool. I ran away from my father, the fool. Now it's okay to talk. What are our problems? Alcohol. Today we have this Red Bull. I don't drink Red Bull. I drink the real stuff, brother. The good stuff. Girls, Haram money. These are the problems that we face today. But how do these problems come? How do these problems come, my brothers? We said that the battle is between us and Shaitan. Anyone here who has a girlfriend, anyone here who drinks alcohol, anyone here who drinks, you know, smokes pot rather, hashish, cocaine, heroin, whatever it is. Shaitan never came to you and said to you, brother, you should have a girlfriend now. How does he come? It's just a look. It's just a cigarette. No, I'm just trying it. I'm just trying it. You know, there's a story that I want to share with you. It's the story of Barsisa. Anyone heard the story of Barsisa? Yeah, you've heard the story of Barsisa? Barsisa was a great abid from the time of Banu Israel. Great abid, great pious man. He was a monk. Yani nowadays, a sheikh. And my brothers, as I share the story of Barsisa with you, don't think of Barsisa, think about yourself. Put yourself in the shoes of Barsisa. Barsisa was a great scholar, someone who worshipped Allah, very pious, the whole community knew about him. He had his own temple, where he worshipped Allah day and night. And three brothers, they wanted to go in jihad. But they had a sister. And they said, you know, if we go to jihad, who's going to look after our sister? So they said, who better than Barsisa? He's a great abid, he fears Allah, everyone, you know, he's of high esteem. Who better than Barsisa to look after our sister? So they came to Barsisa. Now look at the trick of Shaitan. Look where it starts, my brother. They came to Barsisa and said, Barsisa, we want to go for jihad, and we're wondering, can you look after our sister? So Barsisa immediately says, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim. This is shaitan. No way. So the men were disappointed and they left. Then shaitan came to Barsisa. He's not shaitan. Today he's our sheikh. So we'll call him Sheikh Shaitan. So Sheikh Shaitan came to Barsisa and said, Barsisa, brother, what are you doing? These men, they want to go for jihad. They're going for good. They're going for the sake of Allah. Barsisa, if you do not look after her, who's going to look after her? You are the most noble, Barsisa. You are the most pious man. If they leave her with someone else, what do you think will happen? So Barsisa says, maybe I should look after her for the sake of Allah. For the sake that these brothers, look at the trick of Shaitan, my brothers. When Shaitan knocks on your door, Shaitan does not want you to open it fully. Just a little peep. A little, who is it? That's all he wants. A little crack. That's all Shaitan wants. Shaitan has all the time in the world. Shaitan wants a little crack. So he calls the brothers back. He says, listen, for the sake of Allah, I will look after your sister, but she will not stay with me. Barsisa was a man who feared Allah. He was a genuine man who feared Allah, my brothers. Now I want you to think about yourself and relate this story to your life. He says, I will not keep your sister with me. She will stay in the house I have at the back of my temple. She will stay there and I will stay here. The brothers agreed. Said, no problem. The brothers went to jihad. And Barsisa would cook some food for her. and put the food outside his door and make her come out from her house, come all the way, grab her food and go back. Look how much he feared Allah. But what happened? He already opened the door. So this happened for some time, and Shaitan has plenty of time on his hands, no problem. Take your time, brother, take your time. Until eventually, Shaitan comes to Barsisa, he says, Barsisa, don't you know that when you put the food outside, she has to come from her house, walk all the way to grab her food, and this is a fitna, people can see her. People can see her. So I think, Barsisa, this is Sheikh Shaitan now, his friend. Sheikh, I think you should put the food on her doorstep. Makes logic sense? So Barsisa cooks her food, goes to her door, knocks on her door and comes back. After some time, Barsisa, Sheikh Shaitan says to Barsisa, she still has to open her door, put the food inside the house. So this happened for some time, and the brothers took long. Now Sheikh Shaitan says to Barsisa, you know, it's been a long time. This woman has no one to talk to, no friend. Nobody to socialize. Maybe you should talk to her. Otherwise she will go outside and Allahu A'lam cause fitna outside. For the sake of Allah. Not for... No. Brother, for the sake of Allah. So Barsisa now he goes to the house. Look, he still fears Allah. From outside the house he's talking to her. Shouting and she can't hear him properly and... After some time, Shaitan says, Barsisa, why are you embarrassing yourself? You're screaming and shouting. Go inside the house and speak to her there. My brothers, after some time, he started speaking to her inside the house. What was a little conversation became a longer one. After talking, now he wants to see. After seeing, he now started to touch. And after touching, the great Barsisa committed zina. How many of us, maybe we have not committed zina, but we fell in the same footsteps of Barsisa. Now he's committed zina. She falls pregnant. She gives birth to a baby boy. And Shaitan now comes to Barsisa, says, Barsisa, brother, bro, if the brothers come back and see this young boy, and you were the one who was responsible for looking after her, how will you explain the boy? Now he's worried. He says, what do I do? He says, Barsisa, you have to kill the boy. You have to get rid of the evidence. So Barsisa kills the boy. What do we have now? Zina and murder. After some time, Sheikh comes back, says, Barsisa, do you really think she's going to keep quiet about what happened? Do you really think she's not going to tell her brothers about what took place here? He says, what do I do? Kill her too. Zina and double murder. The brothers come back. Barsisa, where is our sister? He says to them, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Your sister, she became very ill and Allah took her life. Barsisa is a great abid, big sheikh. He does not lie. Please brothers, can we move forward? There's brothers standing. Please Malish, we can all squeeze in here. Look, there's plenty of room. We come forward. Come in, come in, look, you know here there's plenty of room here. He says to the brothers, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Your sister, she became very sick and Allah took her life. The brothers had no other option. They said, where is she? He showed them a fictitious grave, a fake grave. He said, this is where she is. They made some dua for her and went home. The next morning, one of the brothers, he says, you know, I had a very interesting dream last night. The other brother said, I had an interesting one too. What did you see? He says, I seen in my dream that our sister was not sick. Rather, she felt pregnant, she had a boy, and her and the kid were murdered. And I seen that she was not buried where he showed us, but she was buried somewhere else. So the other brother says, Zina Ajib, I had the same dream. So they said, both of us cannot be wrong. They went to where they seen in their dream, they dug up that grave there, they found their sister and the baby there. They went back to Barsisa, they said, Barsisa, you lied to us, this is what took place. And now we're taking you to the ruler. Look at the trap of shaitan, my brothers. Look at the trap of haram. Look at what looking at, just one look at a girl. Just one look. One cigarette, brother. Brother, it's only a cigarette. I'm not having pot. I'm not having, no. I'm not having a hashish. No. It's just a cigarette, brother. Yes, my brother, now it's just a cigarette. Brother, now it's just one look. Brother, now it's just SMS between you and her. Now she's just a Facebook buddy, you know. But tomorrow, my brother, you don't know where that is. You see, if you and I are walking now on the same road, and I take a one degree angle, just 1 degree. How many degrees are there? 360. I'm only taking one. If I take 1 degree, can you notice it? Very little. But after a long distance, though it's only 1 degree, how far will I be from the original point? Big gap. So yes, it's one glance. It's one look. Yes, it's one text message. Yes, it's one loan. Sometimes, brother, I'm stuck now. I'm only taking just this one credit loan, just one time. You know, I'm choking, brother, I'm choking. So yes, it's only once. But once you open that door, my brother. So now they're taking Barsisa where? To the ruler. Now on the way, Barsisa is looking at himself, he's thinking, how did I get in this mess? Zina? Double murder? And now I'm going to be executed. So, when they bring him to the ruler, Shaitan comes to Barsisa in the form of man. He says, Barsisa, do you know who I am? He says, no. He says, Barsisa, I am Shaitan. And I am the one who caused you all this mess. And I'm also the one that can get you out. Look at, what did we say before? Shaitan will come to you when? At the moment of? And what will he give you, 50%? 100%. And Barsisa, was he what? Was he someone that was an ordinary person? What was he? Alim, Abid, he was a scholar. He was a righteous man. But because he opened the door to Shaitan once, and he didn't open the door, he had a peep. Today we have the floodgates open. We don't have doors, we have doors, windows, shutters, everything is open for Shaitan. He says, Barsisa, I can get you out, man. I have a lifeline for you, Barsisa. He says, anything. Get me out of this. He says, Barsisa, you make sajda to me. You make sajda to me, Barsisa, and I will get you out. So Barsisa, he makes sajda to him. And Sheikh Shaitan says, thank you very much. It was nice knowing you. Assalamu alaikum. And shortly after, he was crucified and killed. The last action in his life was what? Shirk, kufr to the highest level. How? From opening the door. When he opened the door, for whose sake did he open it? For the sake of Allah. But look at where it led him, my brother. My brothers, I see a lot of young faces around today. My brother, I'm not here to tell you halal, haram. It's your business, bro. Do what you want. But wallahi, my brother, you open the door for shaitan, and this will be your end. You cannot outsmart shaitan, my brother. Shaitan has been there since when? Before Adam. He was there before Adam. He has more experience. Shaitan has more knowledge. Shaitan has more knowledge about Islam than you, me, and every scholar. Every scholar, every Mawlana, Sheikh, Mufti, whatever you call him. If you collected all the scholars of the world and put them together here, Shaitan has more knowledge than all of them. Do not play games with Shaitan, my brother. Do not play games with your life. Do not take chances. Brother, you are here for 50, 60, 70. How long will you live? How long will you live? 100 years? 110? How long will you live? Then you will die, my brother. And then this dunya is all over. And then whoever of you he did good, you will see. And if you did bad, you will also see. So my brother, what is the purpose of your life? To worship Allah. You know, my brothers, there are two states. There are only two conditions. You are either worshipping Allah or you're worshipping your nafs. One of the two. It's never in between. Don't ever think that you are in between. Iman is two conditions. There is no middle ground. Iman is two conditions. Either up or down. You're either worshipping Allah, making your namaz, reading your Quran, going to Hajj, going to Umrah, paying your charity, learning your deen, giving dawah, up, 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 up. Or you're... Brother, I'm busy, man. I'm inshallah. And this is the trick. This is the trick of shaitan. I'll show you another trick. Brother, inshallah, you come to a brother, you tell him, brother, why don't you come to the masjid, you know? Come to the masjid, learn your deen, you know, stop making your namaz in the masjid, stop making your salah in the masjid, learn to read Quran. Brother, I love Allah. And I love Rasulullah. I love them. But brother, right now I have some school. As soon as I finish school, as soon as I finish my school, I will be there, inshallah. Inshallah, I will join you as soon as I finish school. Then you wait for the brother to finish school, then what happens? Brother, you know, Allah says, do not forget your portion of dunya. Brother, look, I have some university, inshallah. As soon as I finish my uni, As soon as I get my degree, inshallah, I'm with you. I'm with you, inshallah, as soon as I finish my uni. My brother, this is the same song every one of us sings. You know how there's the Bollywood movies? We also have our own Bollywood movie with the background dancers and everything is happening. Yeah? As soon as I finish school, as soon as I finish uni, then what happens when I finish uni? Brother, I need a job, man. You want me to go to the masjid hungry? What's wrong with you, man? As soon as I get a job, inshallah. Inshallah, as soon as I get a job, brother, where? I'm with you, man. I'm with you in the masjid, brother. I love Allah and His Prophet. My brothers, who are we kidding? So the brother gets a job. Then you come knocking on his door. Salaam alaikum, salaam, brother. How are you? Allah, I'm good. When are you coming, brother? Brother, big fitna now. I have to get... You all know the song, huh? Everyone knows the song? Brother, I have to get married, man. Brother, you know? I can't sleep at night, man. Okay, let's get married. Brother, I know a good girl. First, my family has to approve of her. And her family has to approve of me. And if I'm not from a good family, she won't accept it. And if she's not from an equal family of mine, my family also will not. And you see, brother, because my brother, when he got married, he has lots of money. They had a big wedding. So now I also have to have a big wedding. And the tricks of shaitan, and the tricks of shaitan, and the tricks of shaitan, and the vicious and the poison of shaitan, and with all due respect, the mothers and the fathers who have no deen in their life, instead of protecting their children and making marriage easy, instead of protecting their children and following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and making nikah easy for the people, haram has become so easy now. Haram has become so easy, and to perform halal has become mission impossible. Brothers are 30 and 32 and they're still single. I ask you, if someone is 32 years old and he's not married, what do you think he's doing at night? Who are we kidding? Who are we playing games with? The father will rather have his daughter, she's 35 and 40, single, because the brother that knocked on the door, he was not from the same social gathering or the same social circle. Social circle. These are the games we play now. We've made halal impossible and haram easy. So now the brother has to work until he's 30 years old, man. Fine. Brother, don't cry. Do not complain. Fathers, do not complain when your son loses control and you cannot control him anymore. This was the seed that you planted. Today we think we're protecting. Today our sisters are spending half the night in their rooms on Facebook. I'm not saying they're evil. But you open the door to this shaitan. You open the door to internet. And eventually you're going to look at something you should not be looking at. Eventually you're texting someone you have no right to be texting. Then we're waiting. He got married. Allah, alhamdulillah, nikah. MashaAllah. Beautiful nikah. Very nice. Brother, you know, I wanted a separate wedding, but her father would not accept. Allah knows what's in my heart. Wallahi, man, the games we play with Allah. Because of social expectations, and my family and her family, we begin the nikah on haram. And we expect it to finish on halal. My son is giving me trouble. Yeah, no wonder, brother. Instead of making nikah simple, humble, achievable, brothers, make it easy. Sometimes a brother, he says to me, but brother, I have money. Brother, I know you have money. But if you set the example, everyone else will follow you. So yes, you have money, but humble yourself for the sake of Allah, so that others in the community, you make it, you have rahmah on them. Because you become the yardstick. Don't you understand, my brothers? Please wake up. Please wake up. Please, please wake up. Sometimes, brother, it's halal. Yeah, but brother, I understand it's halal. But don't you understand that you're crippling a society? When the, you see, the poor follow the footsteps of who? Of the rich. So yes, you have a beautiful big nikah, you're okay, you and your family can pay for it. But you have now set the standard for the rest of the community. People are struggling to pay rent. Mothers, please understand this. Fathers, please wake up. Have rahmah on your ummah. Have rahmah on your children. Oh, but brother, you know, don't tell me brother. Allah is a Razzaq. Don't ever think if I obey Allah, Allah will punish me. What's happening? So he gets married. Very nice nikah. Very big haram. Music and dances and whatever have you. Okay. Brother, inshallah, you ready for the masjid? Brother, it's a little bit sensitive now. We're still honeymooning. Where? Honeymooning. Brother, I promise you. Look at the trick up. Wallahi, my brothers, this is the song we're all singing. Brother, inshallah, as soon as I, just this little period, as soon as we get over it, yeah, she still feels uncomfortable in the new house. You know? She was in her parents, you know, so she's uncomfortable now. Inshallah, just give me some time and then I am with you. I'm with you. Okay. How long do you need, brother? 6 months, a year? Okay, 6 months, a year. Come back after a year. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. How are you? Allah, alhamdulillah, brother. Sure, what's happening? Oh, you did not hear the good news? No. What's the good news? She's pregnant. Allahu Akbar. She's pregnant. Yeah. Brother, she's going through some changes in her body now. Lots of morning sickness, vomiting. I need to be there for her. And this is the cycle, my brother. Until you're 60, 70 years old. You're an old man now. And your children are dragging you to the masjid. My brothers, what is the purpose of my life? What is the purpose? To play these games? Maybe you have a different song. Some brothers are thinking, what's this man on about? Maybe you have a different song. Brother, now we are in negotiation with this big company, inshallah. And I'm just waiting for the contract. As soon as we sign this contract, brother, Allahu Akbar, big fatah, inshallah. Big fatah. I will make so much money, inshallah. I will build masajid. I won't just come to the masjid. I will build you one. Okay. Big contract. Okay. No worries. We have a meeting. Today we have a meeting. Okay. We go to the meeting and there is a A female. Oh, no. Hi, how are you? Good, how are you? Oh, no. Brother, I only shook her hand for the sake of Allah, brother. Brother, what impression am I going to give non-Muslims? I did not want to embarrass her, brother. Look how noble. Look how God-fearing he is now. Brother, you put your hand in the hand of a foreign woman. And you are foolish enough to think that that pleases Allah? Where are we, man? Rasulullah, he says in the hadith, give me your ease, huh? He says, my brother, it is better for you. It is better. Better for you to have a nail. You know a nail? Not these ones. He says, an iron nail to be driven in the back of your skull and through your brain. This is better for you than to touch a foreign woman. And you think there's going to be barakah in this money? You sat down and made contract with women as you touched their hands? What is happening? Brother, inshallah I will make tawbah. Allah is Ghafur Rahim. Brother, why are you so strict? What's wrong with you people with beads, man? Have rahmah. Allahu Akbar. Have rahmah. Make deen easy for people, brother. Why are you making it so complicated? Because this is my father's deen? I ask you, really, is this my father's deen? Do I have the rule book, Yani? I can pick and change and choose and subtract and add and amendments? Amendments now? Do you think I should make amendments to the Quran because you have a business contract? What game are we playing? So we signed the contract, alhamdulillah. Big news, big fatah. But inshallah, it will take some time. How long do you need? Approximately 6 to 1 year. About 6 months to 1 year. Okay, inshallah. You come after 1 year, brother, you don't understand what just happened. They were so happy. They want another one. Now I will build 2 masjids for you, wherever they are. And look at us now. How many successful is there in this town? Many Muslim? Many? Many millionaires? Clean shaven, huh? MashaAllah. How many millions? Lots of money? Still going to work every day? MashaAllah. Some of them maybe haven't even performed Hajj. Oh no, no, he does Umrah every year. MashaAllah. We do Umrah. My brothers, can you see where I'm going with this? Or do I have to give more examples? Do you understand now what's happening? My brother, where are you? Where is your condition? Where do you fit in this Bollywood movie? My sister, where are you? What is your condition? And what will our condition be? We've neglected Allah for 60, 70 years. And now when shaitan comes and gives me his full attention, I think I'm going to pass. Wallahi, my brothers, I can, wallahi. Now my heart hurts me so much. Because I was also exactly like this. I was foolish enough, exactly like this. And I'm not saying I'm saved either. But alhamdulillah, I'm on a better path than I was before. And this is what we want for everyone. This gathering here, is not to teach you halal and haram. Rather, it's to wake you up. And you ask yourself, what is the average age here? 30 years? Some 30, some 40, some elder, yeah? Brother, look back at your 30, 40 years. And you ask yourself, you know, I'm not going to ask. Umar ibn al-Khattab says, judge yourself before you are judged. Fine. You ask yourself, in the 30, 40, 50 years, what have you achieved? What have you achieved? What amal, what action do you have that you are so proud of? You are so sure that when I stand before Allah, I'm going to put this action on the table and say, Ya Allah, judge me on this amal. What do we have? Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the last days of his life, he would hold the Quran and read the Quran and say, by Allah, the only thing that stopped me from memorizing you was jihad in the way of Allah Azza wa Jal. Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi would say, by Allah, on his last days, the only thing that deprived me of ever performing Hajj. Salah ad-Din Ayyubi never ever performed Hajj. The man who opened Jerusalem never performed Hajj. He never performed it. But he used to say, the only thing that deprived me of Hajj was fighting in the way of Allah. I ask you, my brother, what will you say? What deprived you of namaz? What deprived you of Quran? What deprived you of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Work? Business? Women and cars? Hanging out with the boys? Drinking alcohol? What deprived you? Do we have time? Allah, my brothers, you know, you can fool me and I can fool you. But don't fool yourself. Don't play games with yourself. My brother, you will die. Every one of you will die. And every one of you will stand alone before Allah. And you will not have your boys with you. You will not have your mother and your father with you. You will not have your sheikh with you. You will stand alone. The Prophet of Allah, he tells us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about when Munkar and Nakir come to you. When the two angels come to you in your grave. He says, and they will have voices like thunder and eyes like lightning. You know, have you ever heard thunder? Did you ever hear thunder unexpectedly? Wallahi, a grown man, he shivers. Little kids start crying and run. Imagine you're in your grave. You're 6 feet under. It's dark. You're alone. There's no one there. You're scared out of your brains. And these two massive angels come with two huge hammers. And they speak to you with voices like thunder. And they ask you, who is your Lord? Who is your Lord? And who is your Prophet? And what is your deen? How do you think you will answer these? There is a story, I don't know the authenticity of it. I don't know the authenticity of it. But there is a story that says, when Rasulullah was saying this to the companions, Umar ibn al-Khattab asked him. He says, O Prophet of Allah, when they question me, will I be conscious? He says, yes. So Umar ibn al-Khattab nodded and walked away. Almost like as if to say, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it. So it is said that Jibreel came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and explained the condition of Umar when the angels come. So he calls Umar ibn al-Khattab back and he says, it has just been explained to me that when the angels come to question you, Umar, when they ask you who is your Lord, you will say, Allah is my Lord, who is your Lord? Islam is my deen, what is your deen? Muhammad is my prophet, who is your prophet? The angels will walk away thinking, did we go to question him? Or was he sent to question us? This is a man, this is a heart that lived Islam so much that he will answer Islam. He loved Rasulullah and followed Rasulullah so much, he will say, Rasulullah is my prophet. And this is a man who knew Allah so much, he worshipped Allah so much, he spoke about Allah so much. When they come to ask him, he will say, Allah is my Lord. What makes you think? You see, my brother, you know, when I was young and they used to tell us about the angels and that question, I used to get so scared that, you know what I used to do? I used to write the answers down. When I was a young boy, I used to write the answers down. And I used to go over them and I wanted to memorize them. Until someone said to me, brother, what are you doing? I said, my brother, I'm memorizing the three questions. He says to me, brother, don't you know that dead people don't talk? You can memorize it, brother. But a dead man cannot move his tongue. Who answers the angels? What organ in your body answers the angels? The heart. And the heart, my brother, doesn't lie. The heart knows if you love Allah more than money. And how does it know? Through your actions. So for many of us, my brothers, when the angels ask who is your Lord, the heart will say the rupee. The rupee is my Lord. And we laugh now. Brother, astaghfirullah, what are you saying? You calling me kafir? A'udhu billah. I did not say this. I said the heart will speak. And the heart knows. I'll give you an example. Do we like examples? Yeah? Examples, huh? Let's give examples. Allah says, we created you, we created the human being and the jinn to worship me. Liyabudun. What is worship? It is submission, obedience. Allah says, jump, we say, how high? Allah says, run, we say, how fast, how far, what direction, ya Allah? You tell me, ya Allah. This is ibadah. This is liya'budun. So you ask any Muslim, tell him, brother, who do you worship, Allah or money? Astaghfirullah, brother. I worship?
Allah.
Okay. Allah. Have you seen the traffic in this country? Anyone seen the traffic? How do you people still live here, man? I don't understand. You know, Australia has 22 million people. I think I counted 22 million in one street. Huh? Honestly, I think I counted 22 million in one street. Anyway. So in peak hour traffic, how long does it take you to get to work? Minimum 1 hour, huh? Minimum. Okay. At Fajr Namaz, when the Mu'addin, this is a big disease. Today we think Adhan is to indicate that it is now time for Namaz. No! The Adhan is calling you to the house of Allah. What does the Mu'addin say? دخل وقت الفجر Or does he say, Hayya ala salat? What does he say? Hayya ala salat, which means come to prayer. Then he says, Hayya ala falah, come to success. Is he telling you, brother, just a kind reminder to let you know that it is now time for Salat al-Fajr. Inshallah, when you get the chance, when your bus gives you a break, inshallah, when your wife gives you permission, please pray your Fajr. Thank you. Is this the purpose of Adhan? Allah is calling you for falah. Allah is calling you to success. And where are we at Fajr? And then your boss calls you for work at 7, 8 o'clock in the morning. Where are you then, brother? You're in the car for 1 hour answering his call. I ask you, brother, who do you worship? Don't answer. Rhetorical question. Who do you worship? Will this heart say Allah? Or will this heart say Rupi? Brother, don't play games with Allah. Don't play games with Allah. So forgive me, I've taken too much of your time. And it's time to wrap it up. You know, my brothers, the purpose of life is to worship Allah. 50, 60 years and we're leaving. Don't be fooled with TV and music. And this is all rubbish. Wallahi, it's rubbish. 50, 60 years and we're leaving. Rasulullah says, my example, life in this dunya, he says, my example is like one of you is traveling in the desert, he sees a tree, he takes some rest under that tree. How long? A small nap, and then continues on. Brother, you enter this dunya naked, and you leave naked. You take nothing with you. Brothers, please don't play games. Every single one of us should wake up and make Allah and His deen number one priority. I will not answer the call to work if I fail to answer the call of Allah. And I'm not saying tomorrow morning every one of you is going to wake up a big Mawlana. No. But there is a lot of changes that you can do in your life now. Small changes. Small changes. And every single one of us needs to do this, my brother. Some of the things, very quickly, because I know now some of us are thinking, okay, what do you think I can do? You know, my brothers, I personally, start your day in the masjid. Fajr has to be in the masjid. The Prophet of Allah, he says, وَمَنْ صَلَّ الصُّبْحَ فِي الْجَمَاعَةِ فَكَأَنَّهُ قَامَ نِصْفَ اللَّيْلِ. Whoever prays Fajr in Jama'ah, he will receive rewards as if he prayed half the night. So I start my day in the masjid. And where do I end it? In the masjid. Yahi, do what you want in between. But if my day starts correct, and it ends correct, then surely what's in between has to be correct. Sisters, please, if your husband is sitting here and he comes home and he says to you, my Fajr and Isha, you need to understand, your life now revolves around Fajr and Isha in the masjid. So if I'm invited to a wedding, and it starts half an hour before Isha, what do? I go half an hour late. I will not sacrifice my deen for anything. These little principles. And then eventually people will start recognizing that if I have a wedding and we're choosing a time, what time do we choose? After Isha. Why? Because no one comes before Isha. This is how societies change. And it starts with one man. It starts with one sister. So Fajr in the masjid. Isha in the masjid. And if you can manage Maghrib, then good for you, you should do it. The Prophet of Allah, he says, whoever prays Fajr in Jama'ah, and then he sits in the remembrance of Allah, reading Quran, making dhikr, planning and preparing things for da'wah. Whoever prays Fajr in Jama'ah, sits in the remembrance of Allah until Shuruq. How long? How long is Shuruq? An hour and a bit? Most mosques here, Ahnaf, so the Adhan al-Fajr is late anyway, right? Yeah? Okay. Whatever. How long? 40 minutes? 40 minutes? 50 minutes? What do I do in that 50 minutes? Everyone complains, brother, there's no time for Quran. You have a solid 50 minutes. True or not? Tayyib. Imagine you have 50 minutes of Quran every day. In 1 year, how good will your Quran be? When Ramadan comes, how many khatams will you make? He says, whoever prays Fajr in Jama'ah and he sits in the remembrance of Allah until Shuruq and prays how many prayers? To the Ka'at. For him, Sahih Hadith, not a Bollywood movie. For him is the reward of Hajj and Umrah. Tam, tam, tam. Full reward, full reward, full reward. Complete, complete, complete. Hajj and Umrah is passing me every single morning. And where am I? Ya Allah, when is the Nusra coming to the Ummah? Brother, who are you kidding, man? Can you see where I'm going with this or... Do you understand? Imagine you're someone who my life does not start before Shuruq. Shuruq, then wherever I have to go, I'll go inshallah. Inshallah, I drive for 5 hours, I don't care. I want you to imagine you died on a day where you prayed Fajr in Jama'ah, you read Quran for 40, 50 minutes, you prayed your Shuruq, you died on that day. Where will you be then? Is that a heart that will say, Allah is my Lord? I think so. Don't you? If this heart doesn't say it, then who is going to say it? So these are the very little changes. I'm now officially out of, I'm actually gone way over my time. Alright? So these are very, very little things. Don't limit it. So many things you can do. Ya afkar, ayat al-kursi after every salah. Rasulullah he says, whoever reads ayat al-kursi after his namaz, the only thing that will stand between him and Jannah is death. Is death. After every single namaz, after every salah, the Prophet of Allah, he says, whoever says Subhanallah 33 times, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Allahu Akbar 33 times, and then finishes it off by saying La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, lahu al-mulk wa lahu al-hamd. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Allah will forgive your sins even if it's the amount of the froth of the ocean. Today we do our namaz and then what? Gone. These are some small changes. Okay, so again, forgive me. Wallahi, I can talk for the next 5 hours. So forgive me. جزاكم خيرا. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.